complex is that Joe Budden addresses Rory and Mo's absence from the Joe Budden podcast. So obviously some of you are aware that I'm a big fan of the Joe Budden podcast. I've been listening to it since its inception, when it was originally called I'll Name His Podcast Later. Probably one of the greatest names for a podcast that ever existed. Unfortunately, you know, over time they changed the name. I long suspected that changing of the name might have made a few people in the team feel a little bit away. Calling it a Joe Budden podcast was a little bit, you know, a little bit misleading, considering the show was less about Joe, more about the friends that surround him. No one really had any idea the kind of people he hangs around, his persona online and on kind of Love and Hip Hop shows made you think like, who would be friends with this guy? Because, you know, he's a little bit of an annoying dude. Then you meet a cast of characters that he surrounds himself with. They all work in the industry. They got great stories to tell. That was what the show was more about. So to name it just after that one person seemed a bit odd at the time. But again, from a branding and SEO point of view, it makes it easy to find. It makes it easy to brand. It's memorable, whatever it may be. It's easy to say, all this sort of stuff. It makes sense that way. Then of course they went through an entire journey doing that show. They signed up with Spotify. They were one of the first sort of like indie podcasts to sort of jump over there when the podcasts were kind of having another moment. I don't know, third, fourth, sixth wave, whatever it was. And then through the Spotify deal, it sort of opened up floodgates, or opened up the, you know, the lens of what you could do with a show like that. It got people interested. That sort of ramped up a little bit. And then towards the end of their whatever tenure it was, I'm not sure it was 3 or 2 year, whatever that contract was, there was obviously rumblings on the show that they weren't really happy with the contract negotiations that they were going on. And eventually it deteriorated to the point where they decided to step away from Spotify and just do it on their own. And now they're essentially just doing it on their own with the Patreon, of course, on top of it, which they've just done recently, adding in some bonus shows and clips and whatever it may be. And of course, in lieu of that, he also launched the Joe Budden podcast, the Joe Budden Network, sorry, which encapsulates the two female-led podcasts. I forgot the names of them. And maybe a few other things going on, right? So the idea, I guess, would be to kind of show proof of concept, show that you can still command the numbers, that it wasn't a fluke, show it consistently across a whole bevy of shows, offer brands and whatever chance to line up and to kind of talk to certain audiences based on what the shows are doing, and then eventually sell or license your network to a distributor of podcasting, whatever they may be, for a higher figure, and then go from there. That, I guess, would be the plan. But obviously, hasn't necessarily worked out that way. Things have changed. We're living in COVID, music industry, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Podcasting has changed. And but the one thing I think that really affected this whole thing was the Joe Rogan experience moving to Spotify. When I listened to the show, and it was kind of, you know, especially if you keep your ear to the ground, you would have known that obviously the Rogan deal was reported to be $100 million. But according to people in the know, everyone says it was a lot higher than that for a 3-year licensing deal where he's not giving them the show. They're just licensing it off him to put it on Spotify, like a crazy good deal, right? And it was reported in, you know, behind the scenes that it was way more than the reported $100 million that he's meant to be getting. And when that happened, it happened around the same time that the contract negotiation with Joe Budden podcast was also deteriorating. So it made sense when Joe heard that, being a narcissist and the overinflated ego that he has, he would get really hung up on it. And I think from then on, basically, the show was on a bit of a downward spiral, it felt like. It felt like, his two main co-hosts, and Rory and Mal, was scratching their head thinking maybe we should have took the deal that Spotify gave them. That was originally a rumor to be $30 million. And then of course with COVID, it stopped a lot of the stuff that they do themselves, you know, on the side of the show, in terms of A&Ring and moving around and doing live shows or whatever it may be. It's never really been the same ever since then. I think that is what kind of set things off. And then of course recently, they've kind of been absent from the show for what, maybe 2 episodes now. So it's basically been a week or so they've been absent from the show, and they kind of semi on strike. And Joe kind of finally addressed it on his show recently. And we'll read the article here. It says Joe Budden addresses Rory and Mal's absence from the Joe Budden podcast. It says as following. When Joe Budden's co-host Rory and Mar were missing from the Saturday's episodes, fans sparked a host of conspiracy theories. This forced Budden and his other co-host Parks to reveal the Rubies and Mar Rory absent. Around 15-minute mark of Wednesday's episode, Budden explains that the Rory and Mar are taking time out for themselves while they work out their respective grievances. Joe was careful not to dive too deep into the root of the problems, but he did fire back at fans for assuming that the interim co-hosts Ice and Savan were there to replace Rory and Mar, and for creating harmful narratives. It said, "It ain't just a work thing," Joe said at episode 27 mark. "So that's my reaction when I see fans try to split up something that's built so carefully over the years. The best thing you can do is what I wish was granted to me when I was going through it, is give time, time. Give everyone time to chill. But truth be told, I said this in many of Joe's verses, none of us are slaves to the audience. No one owes anybody anything," which I kind of disagree. You do owe the fans a lot, but again, this is Joe we're talking about, and he has a very overinflated sense of self, which is a little bit more grating to kind of endure when he hasn't got his two co-hosts next to him. I realize, I think that's part of the thing that a lot of people are starting to see. As great entertainment as he is, shouting and screaming into the microphone, it's only good when you've got his actual friends next to him who can kind of, you know, wait, you kind of off balance it out a little bit, right? So it's just not him just ranting about stuff that doesn't really make any sense. And to be honest, listening to the show itself, I dipped after about an hour. He was talking in circles, right? Talking in riddles. You didn't really know where it was actually going at. And considering how, you know, picky and nosy and detailed, again, other people's business dealing, it was a little bit annoying that they didn't just come out and just say what the issue was. But hey, we have to just, you know, go with what they say. It continues here. As episode continues, Park touches on the difficulties of handling a friendship and business relationship. He explains that he and Joe don't communicate directly about business matters for the sake of their friendship and future projects, which is definitely a good thing to do. He says, "I've been doing business with Joe Banner for a very long time," he added. "I don't come to you with business shit because we have to keep that. We have to keep doing shit. Other people should be doing. Other people should probably have somebody else talk to you or one of your professionals," which kind of irks on the side of what people are suggesting. That supposedly Rory and Joe obviously have had a bit of tension on the show. Joe approached Rory about it. They had some sort of agreement that Rory should take time out of the show and take a seat out or sit down for a bit. Mal heard that and was like, he didn't like the fact that Joe told him to do that because they're meant to be partners, so they should decide as a trio. That then led to Mal deciding he would stand with Rory in his discussion, something along those kind of lines. But if that is to be believed, I think this lends a lot more credence to it, because Parker is basically saying, "Hey, look, I never talk to you about business because I know how you are, and you're just gonna make me angry. I'm gonna want to punch you in the face," which makes sense. It continues here. Although it was assumed that the tension stems from the business dealings, Parks was quick to clarify that it isn't quite the case, and Joe also interjected to reaffirm that the three don't have any beef. He said, "It's not beef," Budden said when speaking about Rory Mo, said, "Nobody has communicated a beef. What they have communicated to me is something is wrong, whether it be our friendship or how we are speaking to each other at the respect level." Instead of focusing on the catalyst of the friction, Joe likened the situation to a star player holding out for a training camp. The OTAs must continue with 11 men on the field, but once the star player returns, things go back to normal. As a result, Budden makes it clear that JBP will always be home of Rory Mar if they want to come back. He says, "I'll eliminate some of the suspense. This is Rory's seat. This is Mar's seat. Whenever they feel like coming back to their seats, then they'll return to their seats. And then what will happen? The same thing that always happens when star player comes back in the team." So yeah, man, it's a mad one, isn't it? It's an absolute mad one. What do I think is happening? Take-wise, I would say it's probably done. This is just a standard sort of pattern and theme that runs through Joe Budden's career. He always ends up kind of, you know, self-imploding and, you know, basically fucking up his own situations through his own, you know, I don't know, lack of tact or whatever it may be. People are saying that he knows how to fumble the business bag. Who knows? We're not really there. We can only speculate, but I would assume that the show's probably done in this regard. Rory's been intimating at the fact that he doesn't really love podcasting that way. Mo's obviously been getting irritated at a few things here and there in terms of episodes. The magic is probably done, and that might have to do a lot with the fact that that deal from Spotify that they originally turned down is looking mighty good in a post, or in a, you know, in a pre-post, whatever it is, pandemic world that we're living in at the moment. And I really never understood why 30 million from Spotify, even if they were asking for your intellectual property, and even if they were asking for the rights for the entirety of what Joe was doing, wasn't a good deal to take in their interim, right? Or just as a kind of thank you gift to the people that were, you know, built this entire thing with you and worked long hours to make it happen. I don't necessarily see why that was a bad thing, because imagine if they would have just took the 30 million and Joe would have been like, hey, I can make all my friends millionaires because I'm one already, but they haven't experienced that yet, so let me make my friends millionaires even though I know the deal isn't good, and then we can just, you know, do it again another time, right? Or I can go and do another thing and come up with another idea. If you're such a genius, why don't I make another idea, right? I could just give them this network, give them the IP for this stuff, and then do something else later on down the line. But this kind of thing that he has and a lot of people have, where they're really hell-bent on making sure that they own everything, even in the beginning, even when they don't probably have a lot of, I won't say rep, but maybe a lot of sort of contacts and bridges haven't been built. Because I would imagine a lot of business, especially in entertainment, because it's so shoddy and it's so slimy and there's a lot of scams involved, I would assume a lot of it is just kind of maybe purposely taking the bad deal, knowing you're taking a bad deal, just so you can get in certain rooms, just so you can have the experience, just so you can have the contact. I'd imagine a lot of it is because we all know what the bad deals are, but unfortunately most of the people making the bad deals are the ones that are also making the good deals, so you kind of have to work with them anyway, right? You're going to have to meet them somewhere along the line. So if you sort of burn that bridge, it might hamper other bags that you eventually have to get to anyway, because the Patreon thing, let's be honest, it's not that amazing, right? They jumped on it probably a few years too late. They're probably still making a good amount of money from it, but in terms of what they could have done, in terms of the money they could have earned, is in terms of like lump sums straight away, it probably would have made more sense to just sign the Spotify deal, get the 30 million, break that off with your friends, and then whatever happens in the future happens in the future. You just kind of deal with it as it goes by, and if it means that you have to kind of leave the show and make your own thing and maybe whatever it may be, then fair play. But at the moment, considering what's happened, considering the way Joe is, you know, he's a grown dude, is he nearly 40, maybe over 40, regardless of what it is, the kind of attitude that he has, it's very unlikely that he changes and things go back to how they were previously. I just think it's just gone too far now at the moment, and it's probably going to be the end of it for what it is, isn't it? But I guess, you know, we had a good run, we enjoyed it, I think I enjoyed it for the most part. It brought me a lot of laughs, a lot of great interviews. You know, the Pusha T Drake thing was flipping incredible, loads of good industry stuff that you wouldn't probably be aware of, many great suggestions and tips on, you know, the sleepers they do at the end, and just loads of great laughs, isn't it? Really, that was what it was. You always felt like you were in the room with them, so you know, cherish that for what it is. But in terms of it returning to how it was prior, it does seem like that boat has probably sailed for now, and you know, that is probably the nature of the game, and things sometimes do end like that.